Hi everyone, this is the third in a series of videos that I'm where I'm discussing various concepts that you need to master in order to be able to do calculation in chemical stoichiometry. So this third topic that you need to master is related to the idea of percent composition, and then decomposition and combustion analysis that will help you determine chemical formulas. So the subtitle for this topic is how you determine empirical and molecular formulas of compounds. So the importance of determining molecular formula is pointed out here. You have to have molecular formula in order to be able to perform stoichiometric calculations. Unless you know the formula of the compounds or the substances that you're working with, you really wouldn't be able to make the conversions that we discussed in the previous concept, in the mole concept. You need to have the formula to figure out the molar mass, which will allow you then to make that conversion to moles from measured quantities like masses. Okay? So this topic then has to do with how you determine the formulas. So there's two experimental methods you can use to determine chemical formulas, and the first one is called decomposition analysis. And decomposition analysis just means that you're going to take a substance and you're going to heat it until it breaks apart into its elements. And then what you're going to do is weigh the masses of each of these elements and then convert those masses to moles and then find the mole ratios of these elements, which will then lead you to the formula. That's the first type, and that's the easiest one, the easier type to understand. And if you go back to, the previous chapter, chapter two, when we talked about those studies by Lavoisier and Proust and Dalton about how they figure out all these different laws at the beginning before the proposal by Dalton of the atomic theory. This is what was really the type of experiments they did. They decompose a lot of different substances, weigh the masses of the elements to figure out the proportion of the elements in the compounds. The second type of analysis that you can use to determine molecular formulas is something we call combustion analysis. And this requires you to burn a substance. Now, you might wonder what is the difference between heating and burning. Heating means that you're just providing energy in the form of heat, and a substance, when you heat it, eventually would break apart into elements. Burning is actually a chemical reaction, and in this case, it's a combustion reaction, which means that it's a reaction with oxygen gas. So oxygen gas has to be present in order for combustion to occur. So when you burn something, you're reacting with oxygen, and usually what happens to the substance is it's going to produce certain types of products. The products you're going to have, generally speaking, that we're going to use to analyze the formulas are carbon dioxide, CO2, and water, H2O. We're going to use the masses of these products, CO2 and H2O, to work back to determine what is the actual mole ratio of the elements in the original compound. Just a quick note here that when we're talking about combustion analysis, we're usually talking about the type of molecules that you can do perform combustion analysis with are usually organic compounds. Organic compounds are compounds that contain carbon and hydrogen primarily, and it contains a smaller number of nitrogen, oxygen, or halogens, which are those elements in the group 7 in the periodic table. Okay, so that's the typical type of compounds that you'll be analyzing for combustion analysis. So let's talk a little bit about the type of chemical formulas that you get, the information that you can get out of doing those two analyses that we just talked about, the combustion and decomposition analysis. Both of these experimental methods give you formulas that is reduced down to the lowest whole number ratio of the number of moles of elements in the compound. So when you reduce it down to the lowest whole number ratio, we call this type of formula the empirical formula, which is the formula that you determine empirically. The word empirical just means that you determine it experimentally, okay, using either one of these two methods, decomposition or combustion. Now, a lot of times the empirical formula that you determine is not the actual formula of the compound, because remember that in, by getting the empirical formula, you're reducing the ratio to the lowest whole number ratio between the elements, and a lot of times that might not necessarily be the actual formula of the compound. So if you need to get the actual formula of the compound, which we often do, the formula that for the actual compound is called a molecular formula. In order to get that, you need to use the empirical formula as well as the molar mass of the compound itself, which you can determine using mass spectrometry, yet another technique we talk about in an earlier video. We use these two information to then come up with the molecular formula, okay? And I'll do an example to show how this comes about. So again, the idea of empirical and molecular formula is just as follows. So for example, we have a molecule in organic chemistry known as benzene, which has a formula C6H6. As you can see here, this is the actual formula of benzene, and it has a structure that's represented by six carbon and six hydrogens bonded together. But when you determine this through combustion analysis, for example, you find that the empirical formula can be reduced down to, of course, both of them are six, so you can divide them by six. So the empirical formula is just CH, okay? But then the actual molecular formula is C6H6. So that's the molecular formula. So that's the difference between empirical and molecular formula. And a lot of times during, you know, when you do those decomposition or combustion analysis, this is the type of formula you get, and you have to somehow work it, do some more calculation to get to this actual formula of the compound. So one of the concepts that you'll need to know when trying to determine molecular formulas and empirical formulas is the concept of percent composition, which we also call mass percent of elements. This is a concept that we talked about in chapter 2 as well when we talk about the law of definite proportion. So you might want to look back in your notes to see how we define percent composition there. So what you want to do is, you know, you want to define percent composition, which is just the proportion of elements in a compound as a percentage, okay? So we talked about how to do this if you have masses of elements and mass of compound, but we, now that we have molar masses, we can also do the same type of calculation. So let me just define this in the next slide. So there are two ways to define percent composition. The one that we talked about before in the law of definite proportion in chapter 2 is the experimental definition. So if you have the masses of elements decomposed from a compound, then you can define the percent composition of a particular element as the mass of that element, right? Element X, let's say, divided by the mass of compound times 100%. So that will be the percent composition definition. You can think of this more as the experimental definition, okay? So if you actually do a decomposition experiment, you weigh the masses of the elements, then you can calculate percent composition this way. Another way to calculate percent composition is just to use the molar masses, okay? And then to calculate the number of atoms you have. So in this case, you can also calculate percent composition by doing the mass of atoms, right, in the compound divided by the mass of molecules in the compound times 100%. Now, you might think that this looks exactly the same, but here you can do it theoretically because the mass of atoms would just be its atomic mass times number of atoms, right? And then the bottom part, the mass of molecule, is just the molar mass of the molecule, right? Or the molecular mass of the molecule, okay? Molar mass of molecule. And then you multiply this by 100%. So let's do a quick calculation using that second definition of percent composition, which is the molar mass definition. So in this case, if we want to know the percent composition of carbon in CO2, for example, the easy way to do this is just to say I have one atom of carbon. So that means that the mass of carbon here is 12 grams per mole, right? And you have one atom. So that's, you can think of it as 1 mole of atom. And then the mass of CO2, of course, is molar mass is 44 grams per mole, and then you have 1 mole of compound, and then you multiply that by 100%. You can see the moles cancel, leaving you basically with just grams, 12 divided by 44. And if you do that, you should get about 27.2%. You can do the same thing with the oxygen. In this case, want to know percent oxygen. It's a little bit different because now you're going to have 16 grams per mole is each oxygen, right? And then in that formula, you basically have 2 moles of oxygen, right? CO2. So there's two oxygens, 2 moles of oxygen or two oxygen, either way. And then you divide by 44 grams per mole, the same total mass times 1 mole of compound times 100%. And of course, if you do all these calculations, all the units will cancel. What you should get is 72.8% of oxygen. Okay, so in the next video, I'm going to discuss then how to use this concept of percent composition to help you determine chemical formulas.